Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Engineer Sir Faraz Ahmed Saab, Dr. Shahid Rashid, Dr. Hassan Soeb Murad, Dr. Salim Janjua, Dr. Sui Yong, Dr. Hasnan Javed, distinguished visitors from China, businessmen from Pakistan, students, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to congratulate the Center of Excellence for CPEC and PETAC, which is one of our leading technical training institutions and playing an important role in promoting technology-related entrepreneurship for arranging CPEC Think and Grow Summit. As you are all aware, that CPEC is one of the major projects of recent times and which has had very big impact on Pakistan. In 2013, when we signed MOU on CPEC in Beijing on 5th of July, it was only an understanding confined to some pages on which both countries expressed a commitment to work together. CPEC was nothing more, nothing less than an expression of commitment to work on this big project. Many skeptics and many cynics were not sure whether anything will come out of this understanding or not. And we are not short of these skeptics. We are not short of these cynics. These are the Bukrats and Sukrats who every day in the evening sit on the television talk shows and spread gloom and doom about future. But alhamdulillah, a project which nation saw as a game changer is today truly a game changer for Pakistan, with more than $29 billion of the $46 billion investment pledged already energized, either implemented or under implementation. This is a world record that in such a short period of time, this scale of regional cooperation has never worked anywhere in the world. This shows the commitment and capability of the two nations to work together and achieve their goals. CPEC is not an ordinary project. It is unique in many ways. CPEC is unique in many ways because it involves two countries which have an unprecedented level of trust, confidence, and the two countries have unprecedented level of trust, confidence, and all-weather relationship that has stood test of times through history. Therefore, there can be no other project like CPEC in which the two parties are sincere and working to achieve a community of shared destiny. This is not a project about government-to-government cooperation. This is a project which seeks government-to-government cooperation, but on the platform of government-to-government cooperation, it seeks to promote and develop a high-rise of business-to-business and people-to-people linkages. That is where the essence of CPAC lies. CPAC is not a short-term project. It is a long-term project up to 2030. It has three phases. The first phase is up to 2020. That seeks to address Pakistan's infrastructural gaps. Because if you have gaps in your economy, if you don't have enough energy, if you don't have a modern physical infrastructure, you cannot build a world-class competitive economy. For past 14 years, before 2013, unfortunately, no government invested in building Pakistan's energy and physical infrastructure. So therefore, in 2013, we were facing two big bottlenecks, energy bottleneck and infrastructure bottleneck for our growth. From 2008 to 2012-13, if you look at Pakistan's five-year growth average, it was 3% growth rate. Just as in 70s and 80s, some economists had coined a term for India's low growth rate, Hindu growth rate, some economists coined the term of Urdu growth rate for Pakistan's 2.5 and 3 growth rate over 5 years. And they were actually ridiculing Pakistan for now getting trapped into a low growth trajectory. Ladies and gentlemen, therefore government chose to remove these two bottlenecks from our economy, because without energy, there cannot be, as I said, an edifice of modern economy. Because energy for modern economy is what oxygen is for human life. You cannot run factories, you cannot run agriculture, you cannot run transport, you cannot run service sector, you cannot run hospitals, you cannot run educational institutions, you cannot run offices, you cannot run workshops. And this was the scene that we were witnessing in 2013. We have very short memories. Let us never forget where we were 5 years ago. What was the state of Pakistan in 2013 when the nation of Pakistan gave us the mandate to come in the government? The country was facing 18 to 20 hours of power shortages. If this bottleneck had not been removed, Pakistan would be in a serious economic and social crisis. There were analysts who were saying that Pakistan is on the brink of civil war due to energy crisis, because these unemployed factory workers who were out of work were demonstrating on the streets. And I hope that you still remember the images of those unemployed workers who were ransacking Wapda and government offices because they did not have work. If that situation had continued another 5 years, where would we be today? So government under CPAC made energy topmost priority. So therefore, out of $46 billion investment that was pledged, $35 billion were allocated for energy projects. All of this investment is no loan for Pakistan. Government of Pakistan did not borrow this money. Again, our Sukrats and Bukrats spread all sort of disinformation among people. I do not know on whose agenda they are working. We should be grateful to the people of China and the government of China and the leadership of China that who stood with Pakistan at a time that when even Pakistani investors and our closest other friends were shy of investing in Pakistan, even $100, they raised their arm to the world and they said, we are coming to Pakistan with $46 billion. This is a country we trust. This is an economy we have confidence. We have confidence in the resilience and the opportunity of people of Pakistan. And that became the game changer for Pakistan. Prior to CPAC, international community looked at Pakistan as a haven for terrorist networks. But after CPAC, international community started looking at Pakistan as a haven for billions of dollars of Chinese investment. And that opened eyes of the world to look at the potential of Pakistani economy. And as a result, today we find that investors from Europe, investors from other Asian countries, investors from Middle East and all over the world, they are now coming to Pakistan to start new businesses and to expand their existing businesses. Recently, a Dutch company made an acquisition of one of our food processing countries with over $450 million. If CPAC had not happened, if CPAC had not changed Pakistan's profile, would this Dutch company ever think of coming to Pakistan? No. Today, leading auto manufacturers from Europe and Asia are coming to Pakistan to set up auto plants because they now begin to see a new middle class market emerging in Pakistan as Pakistan is coming close to 6% growth rate this year, which will be highest in last 10 years Pakistan has ever achieved. So this is, ladies and gentlemen, a story of Pakistan's turnaround. An economy which was stagnated at 3% is today coming to 6% growth rate because of the investments that largely have come through CPAC. While CPAC has provided great impetus to Pakistan's public investment and private investment, the government has also made a major contribution by increasing the development budget of the country from 300 billion rupees to 1 trillion rupees in a matter of 5 years. This would not be possible if our tax revenues had not doubled from 2 trillion rupees to 4 trillion rupees. So doubling of our tax revenue and lowering of the budget deficit, which when we came into government was running close to 9% of GDP. Today, Alhamdulillah, it is approximately 5.5% of GDP. So we have also reduced the deficit. We have doubled the tax revenues. And Pakistan, because of CPAC, has the highest foreign direct investment it has ever achieved in the last 10 or 15 years. These are the positive drivers that are taking Pakistan on a trajectory of growth. Now, it is our duty, it is our responsibility to take maximum advantage that CPAC will bring through improved energy and improved infrastructure. I can speak for many hours on CPAC because I have worked on this project from its inception till today, and I consider it my great humble contribution in my political career to be associated with such an important project. But let me show you one or two glimpses of the impact that CPAC has brought on Pakistan. I hope that you know what is Thar to Pakistan, but many of you would not know what lies hidden underground in Thar for Pakistan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us with a coal reserve whose energy equivalence is equal to oil of Saudi Arabia and Iran put together. We have that much coal reserve hidden in Thar. But for 70 years, there were only talks, there were only studies, and there were only feasibilities. We could not materialize that dream to put our own indigenous coal to use to produce cheap electricity. We were importing expensive oil from outside and producing expensive electricity. So through CPAC, today we got the financing, and Alhamdulillah, the first mine is almost ready to produce Pakistan's own indigenous coal by digging a mine of about 120 or 40 meters deep into the ground. And inshallah, this year, by the end of 2018 and beginning of 2019, we will see the first power generation plant in Thar in production. And now many more are lined up. At the moment, we have more than $5 billion of investment lined up in the deserts of Thar because of this mining project, that this great opportunity has become possible. And you know how much is the quantity of this coal reserve? If we produce 5,000 megawatts per year, we can go up to 400 years to produce this electricity. That is the quantity of this reserve. And we wasted 70 years. But now, Alhamdulillah, through CPAC, this dream is becoming a reality. Through CPAC, we have more than 1,400 megawatts of renewable energy projects happening today in Pakistan. 1,000 megawatt in solar energy and more than 400 megawatts in wind energy. That will give Pakistan know-how in the technologies of future for energy production. Before CPAC, we were nobody in renewable energy. But today, with 1,400 megawatts portfolio of renewable energy, we have become one of the major countries that is entering into the area of renewable energies. And inshallah, in future, we will
produce a lot more from renewable energies because of the know-how that we will get from CPEC projects. Similarly, Gwadar port. This port was there with Pakistan for many years. And I want to highlight one aspect from which we as a nation have to learn lesson, that the work on Gwadar port was first started in 1992 in the first government of Mr. Nawaz Sharif, when he asked Karachi Port Trust to develop a project to develop Gwadar port. In 93, the government was toppled. Then again, when our government came in 97, I was in planning commission, we passed the PC1 from CTWP of Gwadar port. And in 99, ACNEC approved the project, which is the highest body of the country that approves mega projects. And in 99, we signed agreement with a Chinese company to start work on the Gwadar project. But then there was military coup in 99. The whole project got delayed. And it was not until 2002 that they started the work again, and it was completed in 2007. In 2007, a Singapore company was given the contract for operating the Gwadar port. But for 5 years, they did not invest a single dollar in Gwadar port. So in 2013, Gwadar port was handed over to China Overseas Port Holding Company to be the operator for Gwadar port. And since 2013, this company has now invested millions of dollars to develop modern infrastructure in Gwadar. The Gwadar port is today equipped to handle all big ships for maritime trade and has state-of-the-art business center, which I think even is not available in Islamabad. So if you go there, you will be happy to see a five-story business center, which is the biggest building in Balochistan province, is now in Gwadar, and it is built in less than 1 year by the Chinese company. And similarly, we are completing a master plan for Gwadar to be the smart port city in Asia. And we are benchmarking Gwadar with the ports of Singapore and Hong Kong. How can Gwadar be in the same league like Singapore and Hong Kong? How can it become a hub of maritime trade, not just for Pakistan and China, but for the whole region? And this will bring opportunities that are beyond our comprehension today. The whole of Central Asia, which is landlocked, is looking towards Gwadar to be the future port of trade and commerce. The West China, where Kashmir Economic Zone is being developed, will benefit from Gwadar port. And this Gwadar port will be a key in the new global logistics supply chain that will connect the land Silk Route and the maritime Silk Route of Belt and Road initiatives. So therefore, it is important that we learn from the history that our past political instability has cost us dearly. But we must not let our past be repeated, because as Habib Jalib said, I don't remember the exact verses, but uska mafhoom ye hai ki Cheen apna yaar hai aur hame jaan se bhi shayad pyara hai, magar Cheen ka jo nizam hai usko dur se hi salam hai. So we are all very fond of Chinese friendship, but we must also learn lesson from China's success, that what has enabled China to achieve the success that it has achieved. One of the key elements in China's success is that China did not let anyone compromise their political stability and continuity in policies. Because no nation can ever develop with political instability and lack of continuity in policies. So we have to understand 21st century is the century of economics, ladies and gentlemen. Today, countries are not known by what ideology they believe. Countries are not recognized by what system they run. Countries are recognized by the size of their purse and the per capita income they have. Today, the groupings in the world are G7, G20, and G77. And the passport to G20 is the size of your economy. We have to develop a focus on building our economic future, our economic strength, and giving this nation great opportunity so that every Pakistani can benefit from that prosperity. We must have a goal that by 2030, we must eliminate poverty from Pakistan in each and every form. There should be no Pakistani left behind. If we want to eliminate poverty from Pakistan, we have to produce wealth. We have to generate wealth. And to produce wealth, we have to start enterprises which will have success not just locally, regionally, but also globally. And to achieve this goal, we must become a competitive economy, an economy that has productivity, that has superior quality, and that can demonstrate highest levels of innovation. Because today's economy is an economy of disruption and innovation. We must unleash the enterprise of our youth, because Pakistan's biggest asset today is the youth of Pakistan. And this youth is blessed with great talent, and this talent is our biggest resource. Our job in government is to empower our youth digitally, knowledge-wise, and opportunity-wise, so that they can take Pakistan forward on the platform that CPAC has laid for them. In a Pakistan which is secure, in a Pakistan that has abundance of energy, in a Pakistan that has state-of-the-art modern infrastructure, it is now for the youth and young entrepreneurs of Pakistan to go out globally and reach for the opportunities and connect Pakistan with the global opportunities. And China is willing to help us do this. China is willing to help us by sharing their experience, how they have achieved success. They want Pakistan to become an industrialized economy. This is what Chinese leadership have expressed to me number of times. They say that CPAC is not about projects. We are helping you with energy projects. We are helping you with infrastructure projects, not because we want to do these projects. We are helping you with these projects because through these projects, you should launch Pakistan to become an industrialized economy. Without this launch pad of good infrastructure, you cannot take the jump to become an industrial economy. Today, more than 85 million jobs are ripe to be relocated from China to other countries where cost of production is less, because the wages in China have increased manifold. The Chinese businesses are relocating to other countries. I met Secretary of Tianjin, and he was telling me that we had a very strong IT cluster. We had production and manufacturing facilities for computers and other IT related equipment. But more than 70% we have relocated to Vietnam, because the cost of manufacturing due to our increase in wages became uncompetitive for us. We have now moved to Vietnam, and now here we only focus on high value research. Now that is the model that is now beginning to develop in China, where heavy labor intensive or primary engineering industries are being relocated to other countries with less cost of production. Pakistan can aspire to get a major share of those 85 million jobs. But to do that, our business must have deep understanding of China's industry, China's industrial base, China's economy, and find out which are the industries that are relocating to Vietnam, Burma, Myanmar, Laos, Cambodia, Ethiopia, also Bangladesh, India, and how can we get maximum share in areas where we have comparative advantage, and how can we translate that comparative advantage into future competitive advantage by being better in productivity, quality and innovation than other countries. So, ladies and gentlemen, development is a good concept to dream, but development is also a tough job to accomplish. Development journey is not a joyride in some park. Development journey involves cutting the mountains, making the ways, as they say in China, that you cut mountains to make way, and you build bridges when you are hit by rivers. You cross the rivers by building bridges, and you cut the mountains to make your way. Then only you reach the destination of prosperity and development. It is a journey which requires a lot of hard work. It is a journey which requires a lot of perseverance. It is a journey which requires a lot of stability. It is a journey which cannot be accomplished by indulging in political instability. It is a journey that does not go with politics of dharnas and agitation. It is a journey that requires calmness. It requires stability. So therefore, let us commit ourselves to the CPEC project, which is a long march of development and long march of prosperity for Pakistan. There is only one long march that Pakistan needs today, and that long march is an economic long march. We have wasted 70 years. This is the third opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, Allah has given us for takeoff. And if we let it go, we may not get another opportunity anytime soon. We missed an opportunity in the 60s. When we were taking off, we got into 1965 war. We missed an opportunity in the 90s when we were leading the way in South Asia on economic reform, but political instability was thrust on us. Every 2 years, government were being thrown out, playing a music chair game in Pakistan, and India copied our reforms and overtook us. And today, even Bangladesh has overtaken us by following those reforms. And my fear is, if we do not mend our ways, for what is happening in last 1 year, I don't need to speak. because the whole nation is witnessing that how we are proving that we are capable of being our own worst enemies. How are we undermining political stability? What is happening in Balochistan? You don't need to be an intellectual to understand what is happening in Pakistan. But let me say very clearly to those people who are undermining political stability, we don't have another opportunity. Even Afghanistan has achieved political stability of completing 6-year terms. Mr. Karzai completed 6-year terms. Now Mr. Ashraf Ghani is completing 6-year terms. And if they continue this path of stability, my fear is in 10 to 15 years, they will also overtake Pakistan. We cannot afford to play these games. Let there be stability. Let those who are working continue to work. And let people of Pakistan also enjoy the fruits of development, opportunities, and prosperity. So let me in the end say that it is very important what Dr. Ahsan Sohaib was saying. We have also established a consortium of business schools of Pakistan and China. The idea is that the business community on both sides must work together, academics must work together, and provide knowledge sharing of opportunities on both sides. So I would strongly urge that our chambers must subscribe to Chinese magazines. They must subscribe to Chinese newspapers. Today, on web, you can read everything. Your research cells must have focus on China economy so that you can identify what are the opportunities. Traditionally, our businessmen have always looked at North America and Europe as their markets. We all complained that, you know, China ki export aa rahi hai yahan pe. We are running a deficit with China in trade. Well, you know how much deficit India is running with China? $55 billion. But do you hear anyone in India saying, ke East India Company aa gayi? No. China has trade surplus with almost every country in the world because they have mastered the art and science of being low-cost producer in every field. Anyone who will be able to have better cost advantage will be able to have better exports also. So that is what we need to aspire, work with China, develop joint platforms, and not just look at the imports from China. Do you know that China also is importing every year more than $1.3 trillion? How many of us have looked at the $1.3 trillion imports of China annually as an opportunity? Why cannot we get our share in the imports that China is making from all over the world? Why could not we get the share of foreign direct investment that China was making for last 10 years all over the world in Pakistan? Because we did not have an economic vision. It is only through CPEC that now we have turned the tide. In 2013, China was number 13 in terms of foreign direct investment in Pakistan. And today, within 3 years, it has become number one in foreign direct investment in Pakistan. So this is how we are changing the structure of our relationship. So I would say that let us now look at future with hope and commit that we will provide opportunities to our sons and daughters to live a better life through the economic opportunities that await us from CPEC. Let us not let the cynics and the prophets of gloom and doom take away our pride, our successes. Today, the country which did not have electricity for 20 hours has electricity for 20 hours. Jis mulk mein 20 ghante bijli nahi aati thi, agar wahan 20-22 ghante bijli aana shuru ho jaye to ise kya kahenge aap? Haan,
tabdili.
Kya kahenge? Ye tabdili hai ki nahi hai? Ise tabdili kahenge ki nahi kahenge? To phir tabdili to aa gayi hai, phir jhagda kis baat ka hai? Wo mulk jisme Newsweek usko duniya ka khatarnak mulk kehke title page pe story karta ho, aaj us mulk ki international stories ja rahi ho ke Pakistan is the next emerging destination or emerging economy of the world, to aapki khatarnak tareen mulk se agar ek emerging economy ki shanakht aa jaye to ye tabdili hai ke nahi hai? Wo mulk ke jiski maishat ko Urdu growth rate ka taana deke 3% pe fix kar diya gaya tha, aaj wo 6% ki hadon ko chhu rahi hai aur growth pe ja rahi hai, to ye tabdili hai ke nahi hai? Aur ye baat bhi main wazeh karun ke hame kamyabiyan bhi hain aur challenges bhi hain. Import ke upar Pakistan ka gair mamooli dabav hai. ये क्यों है? हमारे जो बाज लिखारी हैं ये मुसलसल नेगेटिविटी फैलाते हैं कि डूम्सडे सिनेरियो, तबाह हो गए, पिट गए, फाइनेंशियल इमरजेंसी. देखिए, हमारे पास तकरीबन 10,000 मेगावाट हमें फौरी बिजली चाहिए थी. दो रास्ते थे, या ये 10 मील का फासला आप जॉगिंग करके करते तो शायद 8 साल में पूरा होता. दूसरा रास्ता ये था कि वो 10 मील का फासला आप दौड़ के पूरा करें ताकि आधे वक्त में मुकम्मल कर लें. जब आप 10 मील तेज दौड़ेंगे तो आपको सांस चढ़ेगा, उसका साइड इफेक्ट ये होगा कि आपका सांस फूलेगा. लेकिन अगर आपके अंदर स्टेमिना है तो आप उस सांस फूलने को बर्दाश्त कर सकते हैं. हम ये समझते हैं कि अगर हम आहिस्ता रास्ते पे चलते हैं तो पाकिस्तान में जो यंग पॉपुलेशन है, हमें 20 लाख रोजगार हर साल पैदा करना है. वी डिड नॉट हैव द लग्जरी कि हम जॉगिंग करते हुए बिजली की कमी को पूरा करें. हमें फौरी तौर पे ग्रोथ में जाना था तो हमने फास्ट रनिंग करके बिजली की कमी को 4 सालों में पूरा कर लिया है. उससे हमारा हार्ट रेट बहुत तेज हो गया है, इंपोर्ट में इजाफा हुआ है. चूंकि सारा प्लांट एंड मशीनरी इंपोर्ट होना था, बहुत मुख्तसर वक्त के अंदर बड़ी हैवी इंपोर्ट हुई है. अब जब बिजली ठीक हुई है तो हर कारखाने वाले ने अपनी प्रोडक्शन लाइन को एक्सपेंड करना शुरू कर दिया. उसने अपनी प्रोडक्शन लाइन की मॉडर्नाइजेशन शुरू कर दी जो बंद थी, उसके लिए मजीद प्लांट एंड मशीनरी आना शुरू हो गया. तो पाकिस्तान का बैलेंस ऑफ पेमेंट का प्रॉब्लम जो है उसकी बुनियादी वजह यह है कि हमने बहुत तेजी के साथ बिजली की और इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की कमी को पूरा करने के लिए मुख्तसर मुद्दत में हैवी इन्वेस्टमेंट की है और उसने गैर मामूली इंपोर्ट्स का दबाव डाल दिया है. लेकिन चूंकि ये तमाम इन्वेस्टमेंट पैदावारी इन्वेस्टमेंट है, ये पाकिस्तान के ग्रोथ रेट को बढ़ाएगी और जब पाकिस्तान की पैदावारी सलाहियत बढ़ेगी तो हमारे रिसोर्सेज भी बढ़ेंगे, हमारी टैक्स कलेक्शन भी बढ़ेगी और हम इस दबाव को और इस जो बोझ है उसको बर्दाश्त करने की भी हैसियत रखते हैं. तो इकोनॉमिक्स हमेशा ट्रेड ऑफ होती है. इकोनॉमिक्स होम्योपैथिक दवाई नहीं है जिसका कोई साइड इफेक्ट ना हो. इकोनॉमिक्स में हमेशा एलोपैथिक दवाई है कि उसका फायदा भी होगा, उसका साइड इफेक्ट भी होगा. तो अगर हमने हाई ग्रोथ मुख्तसर वक्त में हासिल की है तो उसका साइड इफेक्ट ये हुआ है कि हमारी इंपोर्ट्स के ऊपर गैर मामूली दबाव पड़ा है. लेकिन ये दबाव हमारी बर्दाश्त से बाहर नहीं है, लिहाजा ये लोग जो शाम को आके हमें मायूसियों में धकेलते हैं, इनको हमें रद्द करना है. पाकिस्तान की मईशत डूबती हुई मईशत नहीं है, पाकिस्तान की मईशत उभरती हुई मईशत है. पाकिस्तान इज नॉट ए सिंकिंग इकॉनमी, पाकिस्तान इज ए राइजिंग इकॉनमी. Or with CPAC, inshallah, it will touch new heights. It will become center or hub of trade commerce in South Asia, Central Asia, Middle East and China. So let us all commit to that great opportunity that China has provided us. We will work together and we will work harder, better and smarter so that we seize this opportunity for our future generations. And let us commit that by 2030, we will eliminate poverty from Pakistan in all forms by creating economic opportunities of prosperity for all regions and all people, regardless who they are, what is their background and where they live. This is a dream that is within the grasp of Pakistani nation, provided we continue to move with stability and with perseverance. Pakistan, Zindabad.